Come back to another Express Revision course of orthodontics, and today's video is a continuation video of the last topic, which we have talked about the types of the movement, types of the orthodontic tooth movement. And till now we have covered tipping movement, center of rotation, center of resistance, and we were talking about the translation or the bodily movement, wherein there is the movement of the complete tooth. So when the force is applied, there is a complete movement of the tooth in the direction of force. So we have talked about in the previous video that suppose this was the center of the resistance of the tooth here. So when the force was applied, or when the force is applied in the direction, so there is a tooth movement which occurs in the same direction. So the tooth is then moved to in the direction of the force which is applied. So like that, this is a translatory movement when the force applied through the center of the resistance. So translation is when the force is applied through the center of resistance. You do not have to take down the notes, you will get, there is a link in the description box below, and there you will find, and that link will take you to the notes of this particular video. So center of resistance. Now the next type of movement, tooth movement, is the intrusion. So intrusion, as the name suggests, that means in means inward movement. So suppose when the force is applied here, so this is the force which is applied, inward force is applied, so the tooth is going to move in. So there is going to be the movement of the tooth in the apical direction along the long axis of the tooth. So in the intrusion, there is inward movement of the tooth, which is basically in the apical direction, so towards the root, apical direction, towards the bone, away from the occlusion. So this intrusion, it is difficult to achieve. It's difficult, see, also you can remember it, intrusion is difficult to achieve, extrusion is most easy type of movement. So extrusion is just the opposite of intrusion. Extrusion means X, that means going out. So extrusion is the opposite, wherein when the forces are applied and the tooth movement is in the direction of the occlusion. So the tooth is going to move like this in the occlusion direction. In intrusion, though the force we have applied is going to push the teeth apically like that in the apex, so towards the apex, to or along the long axis of the tooth, whereas in the extrusion the movement is towards the occlusal direction. So extrusion is the most easiest type of tooth movement, now you can take it in a sense. For example, if a girl want to go for shopping, and it is very difficult for a girl when she wants to shop, it is very difficult to say no and to stay her indoors, right? So you can remember it is difficult. Like for example, if a girl wants to go out for shopping, and if you say no, you have to stay inside house, you cannot go out, so that is difficult, right? If she wants to go shopping, she wants to go shopping. So that is how we can remember it is difficult. Difficult for us, for the girls, to stay in while they want to go for shopping. Extrusion is the most easiest. Suppose it is easy to take girls out for shopping, so you can remember it out, right? Outward, this is outward, towards the occlusal surface, toward the occlusal surface. So you can remember it is easiest. So center of rotation for both the intrusion and extrusion are outside the tooth. So the center of rotation for both intrusion and extrusion is the outside the tooth. The last type we have is the torquing type. So torquing is the opposite to tipping. Tipping was, see, if we take an example of control tipping, that means there was only rotation or the movement of the crown, right? There was no movement of the root. If you remember, in the tipping, in control tipping, if we talk about, so there is a movement of the crown, and in uncontrolled, both the moves. So if we are talking about control tipping, so the torquing is exactly opposite to the tipping, control tipping. So wherein torquing, what happens, there is just the movement of the root. If we talk about movement of the crown, it is control tipping. If there is movement of only root, then that means it is torquing. So what happens when the forces are applied? So in the on the tooth, and the tooth doesn't move, only the root moves. So suppose this is the movement of the root, there is hardly any movement of the crown. So when the forces will be applied, or we can say when the center of rotation is in the crown, so the center of rotation is at the crown apex, so what happens, there is going to be the, suppose forces are applied, then there is going to be the movement of the root, which we call it the torquing. So only the movement of the root takes place. So let's talk about the center of rotation. So center of rotation, for all the movements we have already talked about, let's just go through and revise the center of rotation for all the type of tooth movements here. So the center of rotation for control tipping is the root apex, if you remember. So if we apply forces at the root apex, then there is going to be the movement of the crown, which is the control tipping. Only the movement of the crown takes place, right? So in the tipping, we have control and uncontrolled. The another type is the uncontrolled tipping. Uncontrolled tipping is the center of rotation is, because uncontrolled, both the crown is also moving, the root is also moving. So the center of rotation is near to the center of resistance. That is the reason both the crown and the root are moving. Center of resistance, because there is no resistance. So both the centers are coinciding, center of resistance and the center of rotation. The another type we have is the translation. Translation, or the another name can be bodily movement. That means whole of the teeth is moving. So the center of rotation is infinite. Then we have intrusion and extrusion. Intrusion and extrusion, the center of rotation is, if you remember, outside the tooth. We have just now we have talked about outside the tooth. Intrusion, there is going to be the inward movement. Extrusion, there is going to be the outward movement, right, towards the occlusal surface. Last one we have, the fifth type, is the torquing type. So torquing is, the center of rotation is at the crown tip, and this is the reason there is only the movement of root which takes place, right? So let's talk about the force which is required for the tooth movement. So the forces required for the orthodontic tooth movement. See, intrusion and extrusion, they require least force, but in particular, for exam point of view, intrusion is the one which requires the least amount of force. So intrusion is 10 to 20 grams of force is required to make the tooth go inward orthodontically. So if we put 10 to 20 grams of the force, then the tooth is going to intrude, go inside towards the bone. So this is the least force. This is the least force. And if you remember, we have talked about it, it is very difficult for a girl to ask stay indoors when she wants to go out for shopping, right? So it is difficult. So going in is difficult. So intrusion is the least force, but it is the most difficult. Difficult to achieve. Another one we have is the tipping. So tipping, rotation and extrusion. all require somewhere around 35 to 60 grams of force. Extrusion, we know that extrusion is the most easiest. Then we have the bodily movement, or we can say the translation. Bodily movement or the translation. Force required to do this movement is 70 to 120 grams, that is moving the whole tooth, the complete tooth. Then the torquing or the root uprighting. It requires the maximum force, which is 50 to 100 grams of force. So, if we summarize it, the most difficult, you remember, most difficult is ask the girl to stay indoors. So, it is intrusion. Intrusion. Then the most easiest, easy. The most easiest is extrusion. And the least amount of force, is again intrusion, which is, if you remember, 10 to 20 grams of force is required to make the intrusion movement of the tooth. Least force is required, but it is most difficult. So these are some important points which you have to remember. Intrusion is the least amount of force is required, though it is difficult to achieve, and the most easiest one is the extrusion. So E for easy, E for extrusion also, you can remember it this way. Now let's talk about anchorage. Anchorage, it is not the anchor of the ship. So if you have seen the Pirates of Caribbean movie, so in that you must have seen the anchor, or any movie. So anchor is used to stop the movement of the ship. It is used to resist the movement of the ship. So anchorage in dentistry works the same way. Resistance to the tooth movement. Right. So this is the purpose of the anchorage. It is going to resist the movement of the tooth. So based on that, we have got some types of anchorage. So we can also classify the anchorage. It can be extraoral if the support to stop the tooth movement is provided outside the tooth. Extraoral anchorage can be headgear or in form of face mask. Then we have intraoral anchorage. Intraoral anchorage is when the support is there present inside the oral cavity. For example, such as an appliance like transpalatal arch or the lingual arches. Also, we can classify anchorage into simple anchorage, stationary anchorage, multiple anchorage, and reciprocal anchorage. So, let's talk about all these anchorage. What is a simple anchorage? What is the simplest type of tooth movement? If you remember, tipping is the simplest type of tooth movement, right? The most common which is used. So the simple anchorage is to resist the tipping movement. So simple is resist the, see all the things are connected. So resistance to the tipping movement is the simple anchorage. For example, a group of teeth when are used to move a single tooth. So suppose if we are using a group of teeth which are going to resist the movement of a single tooth. So that is an example for our simple anchorage. So guys, other example for simple anchorage can be Z-spring. So Z-spring, if you see, it is Z in shape, right? If you can see here, it is Z in shape. So this is our Z-spring. Z-spring is used for the labial movement of the lingually placed incisors. So if you see here, the central incisor this is a central incisor which is correctly placed. Then we have got a central incisor which is labially placed. So a Z spring is used to push the central incisor, right? So it is going to push the central incisor, labial movement, labially, when it is placed lingually. So there is going to be the movement like this towards the labial surface. So Z spring is going to is an example of simple anchorage. Then another example for simple anchorage can be buccal movement of the premolars using a screw appliance, or it can be the Hawley's appliance. So Hawley's appliance, there is going to be retraction of the anterior teeth here. So retraction of the anterior teeth using Hawley's appliance is an example of simple anchorage. So first one is the simple anchorage, second one is the stationary anchorage. Stationary anchorage is going to make the tooth stay. That means it is going to provide the resistance against the bodily movement. See, everything is there in the name. Oftentimes we get confused with the simple anchorage. Basic things. Simple anchorage is the resistance to tipping, right? Stationary anchorage is resistance to, as the name suggests, I always tell you to look at the name first. Understand? Try and analyze the name. In the name itself, you will find most of the answers. So stationary, as the name is suggesting, that it is stationary. Stationary means it is going to prevent the or resist the bodily movement or the translatory movement. Bodily movement is when there is a complete movement of the tooth. So it is going to resist the bodily movement of the tooth. So an example for stationary anchorage can be class 2 intermaxillary elastics. Class 2 intermaxillary elastics. As you can see here, it resists the bodily movement of the mandibular molars so that there is a retraction of the mandibular anterior teeth by tipping them. So there is going to be the resistance of the bodily movement here. So this bodily movement, it is resisting the bodily movement of this mandibular mandibular molars. So that is our stationary anchorage. Another example for stationary anchorage can be, now see, we have got intermaxillary anchorage and we have got intramaxillary anchorage. What is the difference between intermaxillary and intramaxillary? Intramaxillary anchorage. So the difference is that intermaxillary means that both the jaws are involved. So example of intermaxillary anchorage is Baker's anchorage. So how you can see here in this diagram, both the jaws are involved, right? The maxilla as well as mandible. So this is an intermaxillary anchorage. How do you differentiate from intramaxillary? So intramaxillary is when the same jaw we are talking about. So resistance or tooth movement within the same jaw, right? So Baker's anchorage is an example of intermaxillary anchorage, and I-N-T-E-R, right? This is the difference. E-R is also there in the Baker's. So you can remember it, the Baker's anchorage is an example of intermaxillary anchorage, which is when the both jaws are involved. And class 2 intermaxillary elastics is an example for the stationary anchorage. Now the third one we have got is the multiple anchorage, or also known as reinforced anchorage. Reinforced anchorage. So multiple means more than one. When more than one type of resistance unit is used as an anchorage, it is called the multiple anchorage. So more than one unit is used as the anchor unit. So examples for multiple is multiple. You have to write multiple. So MUL means multiple. P we have is the orthopedic appliance. Multi TI. So T we have transpalatal arch. I we have inclined plane. So that is our anterior inclined plane. PL. L we have labial bow, which is a rigid labial bow. Then E we have suede appliance. So you just have to remember multiple for the multiple anchorage. So the multiple anchorage, we have to just write multiple. So T is the transpalatal, MUL. See, MUL is multiple. T transpalatal, I we have is the inclined plane, P we have is the orthopedic appliance, L is the labial bow and E is the suede appliance. So these are the example for the multiple or the reinforced anchorage. The another type we have is the reciprocal anchorage, which is frequently asked question. As the name suggests, what do you mean by reciprocal? So if you all have must heard of the Newton's third law. So it says that equal and opposite reaction. So this is the reciprocal. Reciprocal means reciprocating, that means opposite to that. So reciprocal anchorages, equal and opposite forces are applied for the opposite forces, opposite, right? So this is the reciprocal. So in case of midline diastema, suppose there is a midline diastema which is present in the midline. So in case of midline diastema, when we close it, the midline diastema, so closing the midline diastema, what we have to do is we have to put the equal and opposite forces. So what will happen once we apply equal and opposite forces? Both of these two teeth are going to come next to each other and make love, right? So this is an example for the reciprocal anchorage, which is closing the midline diastema. By mesial movement of the two central incisors. Also, examples for reciprocal anchorage can be a split expansion appliance. Expansion appliance. So, what is it going to do? See, suppose this is a palate. In the midline, it is going to expand the palate by opening up the midpalatal suture. So, what will happen? There is going to be the movement of both the halves of the lateral half of the palate in the opposite direction. So there are equal and opposite forces which are applied. So split palatal expansion appliance can be the expansion appliances, right? So that can be quad helix, jack screws. So there can be the quad helix. Again, we will talk about quad helix and all. Arch expansion appliance, we will talk about the rapid maxillary expansion, slow maxillary expansion. So the example can be the arch expansion appliances such as quartz helix, helix, jack screw. So quad helix can be again used in children. When it is used in children, it works as the orthopedic movement. But when it is used in adults, it does the orthodontic movement. Right, also we can use jack screws. See, two examples we have studied till now in the reciprocal anchorage. Reciprocal anchorage is when the equal and the opposite forces are applied and it can be used for closing the midline diastema. Also expand the maxillary arch using the split expansion appliances. Also, we can correct the cross bite by elastics, and which is again an example for the reciprocal anchorage. Right. So these are the anchorages which we have talked about. The simple stationary, multiple, reciprocal. Now the another classification for anchorages anchorages, maximum anchorage, maximum anchorages when 3/4 of the space is closed by anterior retraction. Suppose we are doing the anterior retraction, we are retracting the anterior teeth and the space which is available is closed by 3/4. That means suppose if 4 mm of the space is available and if 3 mm of the space is closed by retracting the anterior teeth. So that is our maximum anchorage. Then we have got moderate anchorage. So moderate anchorage is when half of the space is closed by the anterior retraction. Then we have the minimum anchorage. When anchorage we need is very less, when the demand of anchorage is very less, and when 3/4 of the space is closed by the mesial movement of the anchor teeth. See, in the maximum and moderate, the space is closed by anterior retraction. So we have to retract the anterior teeth, and 3/4, when 3/4 of the space is closed by anterior retraction, it is maximum. When half of the space is closed by anterior retraction, it is moderate. Minimum, when the demand is less, when the anchorage demand is very less and the space itself can be closed by the mesial movement of the anchor teeth, is our another classification for the anchorage, right? Then we have something known as temporary anchor devices. So the temporary anchor devices, we use mini implant for that as the temporary anchor devices. So we are going to put implant temporarily, which is going to anchor, hold, resist the tooth movement. So this mini implant, you can remember it from the mnemonics, implants. Implants. So guys, these mini implants are small size implants. They are not big implants as we use in the implant surgeries. They are small implants, or we also sometimes call them ortho implants, right? So we have to write I. I is the use of mini implant. That is, we use the mini implant for the intrusion of the teeth. So if we want to intrude a teeth, we know that intrusion is the most difficult. If you remember, it is difficult for a girl to ask her to go inside and not to go out for shopping. So it is difficult to ask a girl to say in, right? So in is the difficult. So which is the intrusion is again a use for the mini implant. Then we have got IM. M is again use of mini implant, which is the distalization of the molar. So if we want to distalize the molar, if we want to retract the molar back, because we want some space, right? So distalization of the molar is again a use of a mini implant. IMP. P we have is the pitch of the mini implant. So pitch means how closely the threads are arranged. Suppose this is an implant. So how closely these threads are arranged. More closer the threads. Here, as you can see, the threads are more closely placed, right? So more closer the threads are placed, tight the pitch is. So that means this is a tight pitch, because we can see here the screws, the threads are closely packed, closely threads placed. That means there is going to be the greater stability. Right, IMPL. L we have is the length of the mini implant. As we are saying, this is a mini implant, that means it is going to be shorter than the usual length. So length of the mini implant is 6 to 8 millimeters and diameter is 1.3 to only 2 millimeters. IMPL A. A we have is the anchorage, which is the use of the mini implant. So we are going to use this mini implant as an anchor unit. So it is used as absolute anchorage, we can say. Absolute anchorage. So it is going to provide absolute anchorage. PLAN. So N we have got nothing. T. T is the tip form of the implant. So the tip form is basically T is the thread form. Thread forming screw. Which is a type of a self-taping implant. So the tip is the thread forming screw, which is an example for a self-taping implant. We have just to tape the screw. It will go just inside the bone. We don't have to do a surgery to place the screw inside or to place the implant inside. It is just the self-taping. We have to just tap it. Suppose this is an implant. So we just need to tap it. And it will go inside. We don't have to do a surgical procedure to do that. S, guys. So this is what do we call the self-taping implants. Implants, I have made a separate video on the types of implant and all. You can watch the video. You will find in the playlist, implants playlist, you will find that video. So talking about S is, first of all, it is used in severe cases. Because we are using it as an absolute anchorage, right? So which is a use of implant. Use of mini implant. Then S is again for stability. So the stability can be of two kinds: short term stability and long term stability. So a short term stability is provided by the mechanical retention of the screw in the bone. And a long term stability is by the union between the bone and the screw. So this is about the temporary anchorage devices, TAD, which we use mini implant as a temporary anchorage device, and the mnemonic is the implant itself. So this is the mnemonic we have. I is the intrusion, so it is used for intruding a teeth. M is the distalization of the molar. P is the pitch. So pitch we have studied, tighter the pitch, that means more closely the threads are arranged, greater is going to be the stability of the mini implant. Length is L for length, which is 6 to 8 millimeter. Diameter is also, this is a mini implant, though that is a small implant. It is less than or smaller than the usual implant. Then A is, it is used as an absolute anchorage. N, we don't have anything. T is the tip form, which is the thread forming screw, which is a type of a self-taping implant. And S, we have, it is used in the severe cases, and also the stability we have talked about. Short term is by the mechanical retention of the screw within the bone, and the long term retention is by the union between the bone and the screw. Now let's talk about methods of gaining space. So in the methods of gaining space, that means a patient is having kind of crowding. So there is going to be arch length discrepancy. So in that, we want some space. And how do we get the space? It can be via distalization of molars. That means we are taking the molars back distally. So anteriorly we get some space. Or it can be expansion of the arch. So arch expansion, it can be via slow or it can be rapid arch expansion. Third one is by extracting the tooth so that we get a space. Also we can do proximal stripping when we want less space. So if more than 5 millimeter of space discrepancy is there, then we do extraction. If less than that, then we do the proximal stripping. That means we are going to strip the incisors. So little bit we are reducing the thickness of the enamel. Also we can do by proclination. So if we procline the teeth, anterior teeth, then we get some space. Another way can be uprighting. Uprighting. Or by derotation. Derotation. If any teeth is rotated, then we are going to derotate it. So let's talk about one by one the methods of gaining space. So the first one we have is the distalization of the molars. So distalization of molars, when do we do this distalization of molars? What are the indication? So indication, you can remember it from the word molar itself. So M means when there is a missing second molar, because posteriorly distal we have got space. So the first molar we are going to take distally. Suppose this is the first molar. Here is the second molar. Right. So what are we going to do? This is a situation wherein there is no second molar present. Either it is missing or it is extracted. So what we can do is we can take this first molar distally so that we get some space anteriorly. Right. So this is the distalization of molar, which we do in case of a missing second molar, or O means known extraction cases of class 2 malocclusion. Oh, one more thing, non-extraction cases of 1, which is class 1. Also, L we have got low mandibular plane angle, or an average mandibular plane angle. Mandibular plane angle. AR is our arch length discrepancy. When there is a mild arch length discrepancy, arch length, AR, arch length discrepancy. So in all these cases we do the distalization of molar, either it is a missing second molar or in the non-extraction cases. So M is the missing molar, O is our non-extraction cases and O for class 1, L is our low mandibular plane angle, and AR is the arch length discrepancy. So what are the contraindications? Contraindications for distalization of molars. I'm going to write CI for contraindication. When we don't do the distalization of molar in case of host, so H is the exactly opposite of what we do in the indication. So that is the high mandibular plane angle. If you remember, a low or average mandibular plane angle is an indication for distalization of molar. But if there is a high mandibular plane angle, then the distalization of molar is contraindicated. O is our open bite. If open bite is present, then we don't do the distalization of molar. Also, same goes for overjet. If there is a deep overjet, or we can say overjet more than 5 millimeters is present, then also we don't do the distalization of molar. S is the severe arch length discrepancy. If you remember, the mild arch length discrepancy is indication for distalization of molar, but severe arch length discrepancy is a contraindication for distalization of molar. Right. Then T, we have two things. One is 2, another one is 3. So in case of class 2 skeletal pattern, we don't do. If you remember, for class 1 we do. For class 1 skeletal pattern, we do the distalization of molar. But in case of class 2 and class 3 skeletal pattern, we avoid doing the distalization of molar. So these are the indications as well as contraindications. So you can remember it: the host, high mandibular plane angle, open bite and overjet more than 5 millimeters, then severe arch length discrepancy, and class 2 and class 3 skeletal pattern, right? So, talking about the disadvantages, what are the disadvantages of the distalization of molar. So what happens? There is increase in the overjet. If we do the distalization of molars, then we see that there is increase in the overjet. There is increase in the overjet. So because this overjet has increased, see, jet is the horizontal distance, right? If the jet is increased, that means there is proclination of incisors, what we see. So it is often associated with the proclined incisors. Or we can say the profile of the patient becomes protrusive. And also there is a thin labial bone and gingiva, and some cases we see also anterior open bite which is present. Because since the majority of distalization methods are extrusive in nature and they would drive the molars posteriorly, and this will result in possibly a wedge effect that is going to open the bite or open the occlusion, and hence it may result in the anterior open bite also. So the main disadvantage of doing the distalization of molar, if we are retracting or keeping the molars distally, stretching the molar distally, taking the molars distally, then the main disadvantage is that it is going to have a high relapse rate, high relapse tendency. So what happens when you are taking the molars distally, then what is going to happen? They are going to come back again at the same position. So we see that there is a high relapse rate which is associated with the distalization of the molar. So what are the distalization appliances? Distalization appliances. What are the appliances which are used to distalize the molars? So first one in the picture we have is the pendulum appliance. Pendulum appliance. Why it is known pendulum appliance? Because this appliance is going to produce a swing arch or a pendulum of force from the midline of the palate up to the molars. So it is going to be in a pendulum motion or the swing arch like motion. So this pendulum appliance was given by James Hilger, and there is a large Nance palatal button in an acrylic plate, and also we see that there are TMA springs that are going to deliver the constant forces, continuous, light continuous forces to the upper six without affecting the palatal button. Also activation is by 90 degree and the forces applied is 200 to 250 grams. Second one in the picture we have is the distal jet. Distal jet. As you can see, this is a palatal appliance, right? It is placed in the palatal position. So also there is a tube, plus also we see that this is a coil spring. As you can make out in the picture, there is a presence of niti coil spring, and which is used to distalize the molars. So it is going to distalize the molars here like this. So niti coil spring is there. Third one in the picture we have is the Johns jig. So if you remember, distal jet was a palatal appliance, but Johns jig is a buccal appliance, right? And there is a heavy round wire. Also we see there is a light wire passing through the molar tubes, right? So this is the Johns jig. Also we have the distalization appliance, which is the lip bumper. This is a lip bumper, right? If it is present in maxilla, then we call it Denholz appliance. Also another appliances which can be used for distalization of molar can be headgear, or implants, or magnet can also be used to distalize the molars. So guys, next one we have the method of gaining space is by expanding the arch. So we have arch expansion. So what we are going to do is, we are going to enlarge the palette. We are going to expand the palette. In case of, suppose constricted maxilla is present. So we are going to, constricted maxilla means there is a small maxilla which is present. So what we are going to do is, we are going to open up the mid palatal suture. So opening the mid palatal suture, we can expand the arch. But we should do it before the fusion of the suture. So before the ossification of this suture takes place, we have to do it. So when this mid palatal sutures ossify, a broad range for ossification of mid palatal suture is 15 to 27 years. But if they are asking in girls and boys separately, so for boys it is 18 years, for girls it is 16 years. Also, we can correct the posterior crossbite with the help of expanding the arch. So this arch expansion, we can do it two ways. One is slow, another one is rapid. Slow expansion means we are expanding it slow. Rapid is what do we call RME, rapid maxillary expansion. And this term was given by Emerson, Angle. So what do we, how do we expand it? As you can see here, there is an expansion screw which is present. There is an expansion screw which is present, right? This screw is going to expand both the lateral halves of the palate. So it is going to expand, and if we make 1/4 turn, or we can say 90 degree turn, then it is going to expand the lateral halves by 0.18 millimeters. So this is the expansion of the lateral halves which it makes, which this, if we are going to activate the screw, or if we are going to turn the screw to one fourth, or if we turn it to the 90 degree, so if there is a 1/4 turn or 90 degree turn of the screw, it is going to expand both of these lateral halves by 0.18 millimeter. And also there is one more term known as pitch, right? We have already talked about pitch of the screw is approximately 0.8 millimeters. So let's talk about the differences between the slow maxillary expansion and the rapid maxillary expansion. So what's the difference between slow and the rapid maxillary expansion? So guys, slow and the rapid maxillary expansion. So this is slow maxillary expansion, and the other side we have is the rapid maxillary expansion. So talking about the slow maxillary expansion, when do we use the slow maxillary expansion? We are going to use it in the primary as well as in the early mixed dentition. In the early mixed dentition period. But rapid maxillary expansion, we can use it in the later on stages of life. It can be the late mixed dentition phase, or also we can use it during the permanent dentition phase. Permanent dentition. So what is the rate of expansion? Because as the name suggests, this is a slow maxillary expansion. So it is going to expand slowly. The arch is going to expand 0.5 to 1 millimeter per week. But in case of rapid maxillary expansion, the expansion, the rate of expansion is 0.5 to 1 millimeter goes same, but it is per day instead of per week. And how much time it takes to complete the slow maxillary expansion? It takes as much as 2 to 5 months to complete the slow maxillary expansion. But for rapid maxillary expansion, it completes fast. It takes 1 to 2 week of time to complete the maxillary expansion via the rapid way. So what are the changes? And let's talk about the force. What is the force which is applied? So because we are expanding the arch slowly, so we are putting less forces, that is 2 to 4 pounds. But in case of rapid maxillary expansion, because the expansion is so rapid that we have to put more amount of force, so that is 10 to 20 pounds. Also, what are the changes? The skeletal to dental changes is 1:2. That means the skeletal changes, so skeletal to dental changes. That means the skeletal changes are only 50% for slow maxillary expansion, but for rapid the skeletal to dental changes 1:1. So let's talk about the appliance used for slow maxillary expansion. So it is a quad helix which is used in maxilla, then the jack screw, then we have W arch, also the coffin springs which is again used in the maxilla, also the night eye expander which is a newer slow maxillary expansion, night eye expander, and the Schwartz appliance which is used for mandible. Then for rapid maxillary expansion, we have got fixed tooth bone appliances are the fixed tooth bone. That means only tooth element is there. The another one is tooth and tissue. That means acrylic will also be present because tissue, it is also supporting, taking support of the tissue. So fixed tooth bone and tooth and tissue bone. So in the fixed tooth bone, we have got his, which is the Hyrex and ISS Isaacson. In the tooth and tissue bone, we have got HD, which is Haas, and also we have Derischwiller. So as you can see here, this is a quad helix. As we know the meaning of quad, which is the four-sided, so it is going to be like this. So this is a quad helix, and this one is our, see, we have studied the tooth, fixed tooth and tissue. As we can see here is acrylic which is present, so this is tooth and tissue, so it is going to be our Haas appliance. Now here we can see there is no tooth component, there is no tissue component, there is only a tooth component which is present, and this one is Isaacson. So guys, let's talk about extraction now, which is the third method of gaining space. Extraction, we are going to talk about the serial extraction. Also, we are going to talk about the most common extraction. Then, we will be studying the term balancing extraction. Also, we will know the term compensating extraction. And last but not the least, we are going to study about Wilkinson's extraction. So talking about serial extraction, serial extraction is a term which was used first by Gellgren, and the father of serial extraction is the Nance. and holds called the serial extraction as active supervision of the teeth. By extraction. So guys, what is serial extraction? Serial extraction is a planned extraction. It is a planned and sequential. So we are going to remove the teeth, we are going to do the extraction in a sequence. It can be of primary as well as the permanent teeth. In order to reduce crowding in case of permanent dentition, we don't want that the child are going to have any orthodontic problems because of crowding teeth, so we are going to correct it before itself. So this is a planned and sequential extraction, right? So when this serial extraction is indicated, indications, it is done for class 1 skeletal pattern. Also, if we see crowding is present, and because of the crowding, we see that the teeth are going flare. So, flaring of teeth is present. That also we do the serial extraction. Also, when we see, because of the crowding, we see that there is a localized gingival recession which is present in the lower anterior region. Then also we do the serial extraction. Or if already there is a unilateral or bilateral premature loss of canine, premature loss of deciduous canine, which is RC. And also we see there is a, along with that we see there is a midline discrepancy. So when there is a space discrepancy also, that case we do the serial extraction. When this discrepancy is at least 5 millimeter in all the four quadrant, and there when there is no skeletal discrepancy, it is in that case that we do the serial extraction. So it is indicated in case of class 1 skeletal pattern, right? So basically the important point here is that when there is a arch length discrepancy or deficiency which is present compared to the tooth material, so whenever there is a arch length discrepancy, in that case we do the serial extraction. Then when the serial extraction is not done, when it is contraindicated, see this is indicated for class 1 skeletal pattern, so it is contraindicated for class 2 and class 3 skeletal pattern, right? Also extraction, serial extraction is indicated in crowding. Any extraction is orthodontically contraindicated in spacing. Because already the patient is having spacing dentition, so there is no need of doing the extraction, right? And anodontia, when the patient is having less teeth, or oligodontia. So no, actually anodontia is basically absence of teeth, and also in case of open bite, and deep bite also we don't do. And if midline diastema is present, any spacing if it is present, either it is a generalized spacing or it is a localized spacing like midline diastema in the center when it is present. So all these cases serial extraction is contraindicated. So what is the procedure? We have got the methods of doing serial extraction. So what are the methods of doing serial extraction? So according to Duell, it is CD4. And according to Nance and Tweeds, it is D4C. What do we mean by that? So C, if we talk about here in the Duell, first one is C. So So what we are going to do, we are going to extract this canine, deciduous canine, because it is going to permit the self-alignment of the permanent incisors. So in order to self-align the permanent incisors, we are going to extract the permanent canine. Also, another one is D, extraction of the D, which is our primary first molar. In order to promote the eruption of the first premolar, we are going to extract the first deciduous molar. Then the next goes is the extraction of the 4, which is the extraction of the first premolar. So if we are talking premolar, that means it is obvious that it is a permanent dentition. It is done to relieve the crowding and to permit the eruption of the permanent canines, right? So these are the cases that we are going to do the serial extraction. This is the procedure. Next one, guys, we have is the most common, right? First one was the serial extraction and in extraction. Second one, in extraction, we are going to talk about the most common extractions, which is a frequently asked question. So which is the most commonly teeth extracted for gaining space? This is the first premolar. Why first premolar? This is a most frequently asked question even for Viva. Why first premolar? Because it lies between the anterior and the posterior segment. So it is a tooth which lies between the anterior and posterior segment, and it can be used for both anterior and posterior correction. Also, the contact between the canine and the premolar is good. So the first premolar is the tooth which is most commonly extracted for the orthodontic treatment. And when it is extracted, when the space discrepancy is more than 5 millimeter. Space discrepancy. So guys, next one we have is the balancing extraction. So balancing, as the name suggests, when we see balancing, we always think of both the sides, right? So balancing word means extraction. Supposedly if there is extraction or there is a missing teeth on one side, then we should extract the opposite side teeth so that there is no midline discrepancy which is created. So if in case of one side of the deciduous teeth is extracted, then the opposite, or it is lost for any reason, the opposite side of the teeth is going to be extracted. It is in order to maintain the midline. So the fourth one we have is the compensating extraction. Compensate means word. We are going to compensate for the one thing, right? So suppose if there is a discrepancy in one arch, or suppose in the one arch if there is a deciduous teeth which is extracted, then in the opposite arch also, so this is the other side we are going to extract, right? So in the opposite arch also we have to extract the teeth, so in order to prevent the supra eruption of that tooth. So this is the compensating extraction. Another one we have is the Wilkinson's extraction. So Wilkinson's extraction is the most frequently asked question also. Basically, Wilkinson's extraction is extraction of the first permanent molar. Here we are not going to extract the deciduous teeth. We are talking about the first permanent molar. Why the first permanent molar? Because this is the most cariogenic tooth. So we are going to extract it beforehand because we already know that it is going to be cariogenic. So this is the concept of Wilkinson. This is not my concept. And first premolar is usually extracted between 8.5 to 9.5 years of age. So this is the Wilkinson extraction. That is, we are going to extract the 6. Right. Now let's talk about the extraction pattern in class 2 malocclusion. Suppose if a child is having or a person is having class 2 malocclusion, then what is the pattern that should be followed for extraction? Either we can extract 4-4 of upper arch, that is the first premolar of the upper arch, or we can extract the 5-5 of lower arch. So either upper arch first premolar, which is the 4, and lower arch, it is the second premolar, which is the 5. Either we can do this, or the other way is we can only extract the upper 4. Right, this is for class 2. So class 2 it is upper 4, lower 5. For class 3, the order is, this is the extraction pattern for class 3 malocclusion. Suppose if a person is having class 3 malocclusion, what should be the extraction pattern? It is 5, 4, 3. Always remember, first 5, then 4, 3 is our class 3. So this you can remember it. So that means upper 5 and lower 4. That is the second premolar of upper arch, the first premolar of the lower arch for class 3 malocclusion. Then let's talk about the proximal stripping. So proximal stripping is stripping off. That means we are going to reduce little bit of enamel from proximal ends. That is the reason we are calling it the proximal stripping. So less than 50% of the enamel thickness is reduced in proximal stripping. And important point to remember in proximal stripping is that it is contraindicated in young patient. Why it is contraindicated in young patient? Because they have got a large pulp chamber that we are going to cover in the endo, or if you have not covered, then you can watch the video in the playlist. So now derotation. See, whatever tooth is rotated, we have to derotate it. Suppose if there is a rotated posterior teeth which is present, so this posterior teeth will occupy more space, right? And if there is a rotated anterior teeth, because anterior teeth is like this, and if it is rotated, that means it will be somewhere like this, so it is going to occupy less space. So anterior teeth will occupy less space. So maximum loss of space occurs, within the 6 months of extraction. So immediately after extraction, we should give the space maintainers, right? So space, there are two things. One is the space maintainer, another one is the space regainer. Space maintainer is going to just maintain the space. They are reactive, but space regainer are going to regain the lost space. So they are retroactive. So what happens, there are situations if there is a early loss of incisors. So suppose if there is a loss of, let's write loss of primary incisors. If there is a loss of primary incisors, there is no big deal. So what we are going to do is, this is the 6 and we are banding the 6 and we are going to give the lingual arch with the acrylic teeth. So we can give the acrylic teeth here. So if there is a loss of primary incisors, we can give the lingual arch with the acrylic teeth for aesthetics. If there is a loss of C, then what happens? Loss of C causes the lingual collapse of the incisors. Therefore, there is going to be a loss of the arch length. So, in that case, we give the lower lingual holding arch, or we can also give the Nance holding arch from the first permanent molar, right? But before giving this lower lingual holding arch, wait for the lower permanent incisors to erupt. Otherwise, what will happen? They'll be trapped because this lower permanent incisors, they erupt lingually. So to prevent both the mesial drifting of the molars and also the lingual collapse of the anterior teeth, we give the lower lingual holding arch. What happens when there is a loss of D? So in case of loss of first deciduous molar, there is no big deal, no big problem. We can always give band and loop. That means, suppose this is a teeth molar which is present. So if there is a missing D, then we can give a band around the teeth and a loop, right? So a band and loop. Also we can give lower lingual holding arch or the Nance palatal arch or the Nance holding arch. Instead of wire across the lingual, it has got acrylic on the below the rugae surface. So what if there is a E which is lost? That is the second molar, second primary molar. Now E loss is a big problem. It is a big problem. So we have to give the space maintainer. Giving a space maintainer E is a must because it is the key to leeway space. It holds the difference between the orthodontic expression extraction. So in case of E which is lost, we have to give the distal shoe. It's not a shoe, it is a distal shoe. So suppose here a D is present, right? So in case of distal shoe, we are going to band around the D. This is the D, right? Because E is missing. So we are going to band around the D, and there is an extension which goes gingivally. So this is an extension which is going gingivally to hold and guide the mesial surface of erupting first permanent molar. So this first permanent molar is going to erupt in a given path because we have given an extension which is going to guide the mesial surface of unerupted first permanent molar. So in case of E loss, or when there is distal shoe, when there is unerupted 6 and E loss, right? Unerupted permanent first molar. But what happens when there is a erupted 6? If erupted 6 is present, then we can give the lower lingual holding arch or the Nance holding arch, right? So in case of distal shoe, remember 3 things. Distal shoe is contraindicated because this is a surgical procedure. We have to go below the gingiva. So it is contraindicated for the heart disease, patient with the poor oral hygiene, and also in the patient with the hemophilia, because it is a small surgical procedure, right? So this distal shoe space maintainer, with the fixed one distal shoe space maintainer, is also known as Roche's or intraalveolar appliance. So let's just write this because this is important. Distal shoe space maintainer, fixed one, is known as Roche's or intraalveolar, because we are going to go underneath the alveolus. Intraalveolar appliance. But always remember this, which is the best space maintainer? So the best space maintainer is properly restored deciduous teeth. Restore deciduous teeth, which is the best space maintainer. This topic is also important for the pedo point of view. So one more thing is there. Child psychology we are going to cover properly in the pedo. So we are skipping that in the ortho lectures. So what are the conditions and what are the space maintainers which we give? Let's just go through all the conditions and the space maintainers, guys. So we have got when there is a bilateral loss, when there is a bilateral premature exfoliation of the teeth, it is present in the maxilla. Then we give palatal arch or the non palatal arch, right? When there is a bilateral premature loss or bilateral premature exfoliation of the teeth present in the mandible, then we all know we give the lower lingual holding arch space maintainer. What happens when the E is lost? Or let's start from when there is an early loss of primary incisors. This is the least indicated situation. Least indicated for the space maintainer. And we can also give the pin and tube. Pin and tube, because it allows the lateral growth of the arch. So what happens when there is a unilateral multiple loss of the teeth? Multiple loss. Then we give the transpalatal arch. Transpalatal arch. And what happens when there is single tooth loss? This is the multiple. When there is a single tooth loss in the posterior segment. Single tooth loss in the posterior segment. Then we give band and loop. So we give band and loop, or also you can give crown and loop space maintainer, right? What happens when there is a primary second molar, that is the E lost before the eruption of unerupted, or we can say unerupted 6 before the eruption of permanent first molar. So in that case we give the distal shoe. This is the most indicated situation for a space maintainer. So distal shoe, also remember that most indicated situation. And which is the best space maintainer? A properly restored deciduous tooth is the best space maintainer. So most indicated situations. So guys, this finishes the space maintainer regainer. Again, we will cover the child psychology in the pedo lecture series. I hope that you have enjoyed this part of the video. So if you have enjoyed it, give it a thumbs up. Also, you can comment in the comment section below, and you can subscribe to the channel to get more videos like this. Don't have to take down notes. There will be a link provided in the description below that will take you to the notes. So guys, till then, keep reading, keep learning, stay motivated. All the best for your exam. Love you. Do well in your exam and have faith in yourself. Have faith in the study. Have faith and do work hard, which is very important. So you have to keep on revising everything. So you can just click on the notes and always you can revise it with all the notes, all the pictures which is available in the notes. So guys, keep learning, keep reading. I'll see you soon.